9:35. We should have bottles of wine here, organizers. And my name is Sir John Weiss. I live and work in New York City. I teach at Columbia University and CUNY and my office called NEO. I also ran the research office School of Physics, School of Physics Studies. And we did a project in including Pristina 10 years ago, so I was here 10 years ago. I'm going to go really fast. I'll skip a lot of things I said, referring to the presentations before. I really want to focus on the positive aspects of the crisis. I think that's the whole point of all my work. Because I live the crisis like you did here in Kosovo and the injustices they did. But I'm not going to speak about politics, I'm not going to do any plans. I'm just going to talk about built environment, art, architecture, subversion, and just to present the case that your case is a global case. And the world can learn from Kosovo as much as Kosovo can learn from the world. Back to the picture, it's a beautiful title. Now let's live up to this. And by that, what actually means future, and how is it defined in a way that we don't remain just within our little mountains. Soft South is what Yugoslavia belonged because of the non-aligned movement. We have to also look at the things which really produce cities and suburbs and villages and why they are like this, not simply how they look like, how they are organized. What are the conditions? One of the conditions was the non-alignment. And my theories is that what we live here, that take out the United States, take out Russia, live in a non-aligned architecture, a non-aligned city. Meaning it's not really aligned with any kind of streams or ideology. It is plural, it is multiple, and it is a kind of island-based. It's an archipelago of things. Anyhow, I'm just showing, I'm also an architect and designer and researcher. So I'm going to flash through some of the work. So you believe me that I can draw. This was a painting competition for Barcelona in 1998. This was actually how we got our name, Normal Architecture Office. It was an absurd competition. 1998 also for Belgrade Hotel under the first Baltic Trend. There was a company making a competition for the Burma Plaza Hotel. And I was in Brooklyn thinking, this is really crazy. Let's do it. But how do we do it? Is that we make a building without any signs, any significations. Building without qualities. No qualities. We won. Never got paid. Nothing happened. I proceeded with my partner to do kind of fictional projects using socialist kind of colors and insignia. This is a project for the elderly socialists somewhere in a small town. This is an ongoing project, this one, for a stadium in Novi Sad, my hometown, to upgrade the stadium to be a center for new recreation and new media. It is ongoing, but we stopped the law not to do a shopping center because of the project. It may never happen. I was lucky to be taken out in 95 from Belgrade to go to Harvard and study there. And I went to New York. And like many architects, did very many small projects on a tight budget for galleries, contemporary galleries. We also designed these things like called Z-blocks that you can sit around. So imagine instead of your chairs, we have some kind of Tetris-like spaces. Also doing some visions. This is a vision for Philadelphia, how to fill up the empty spaces by dirt digged out in suburbia, which they pay no taxes about it. And also did some one-day simulations, interventions with immigrants. These two kids are from Kenya. We had no clue that they're actually coming to the United States. And we also even have some build projects. This is in Novi Sad. It's a crematorium. Good friend, good as a friend says, well, that's great switching, you started from the end. So from death, let's go forward. And that's another shot, that's inside, very simple. The second one, small project, is a compromise in this tower, model this tower. The commission was for this building. We said to the client, give us 10% and you do the rest the way you want. And this is actually the situation that you have. So, other visionaries that I'm really, I love future for the past, okay? And I think you guys can do that. Johan Friedman, an exhibition with him done at the Drawing Center in New York City. I think why I'm saying is it's important to realize that there are visionaries who actually have not realized visions, but they're impacting. another woman architect, which is also important. We had one woman on the panel today, which I was very happy. And Ting, I worked with Loita, we come and develop this incredible scientific models that we can study. You know, this may not be real, like it has happened today. It may happen in her mind in 50 years, but now we are 50 years after her, and we can, you know, do computation, digitization, scanning, all of it. Balkanization. I always show this map. The map is, we know what it is. It's a political map produced by the UN. There are no colors, only boundaries and names. Of course, if we zoom into our territory, where you are too, we see all the numbers. Unfortunately, the number 8 is not on this map, which is of course Oslo as a country, but I'm from number 3, and I have numbers from friends from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, and I did work in all of them. Why is that important? Because it's neutralization of identity. So imagine yourself being neutralized in terms of architecture as your identity, whatever, legal or legal. The thing is global. I'm going to skip this fast. We know there was a very good period in Yugoslavia in architecture of socialism, very sculptural. We did a book on that, about monuments and brigades. The book is out with a photographer. It's important to photograph really well, not simply as documentation, but also these spaces, this is Skopje, opera in Skopje, operates here. This is Nikšić, an incredible home of the revolution, now being under renovation, a very smart scheme. Renovating only 10%, perfect, 40% informal, and then the rest is a park. And there are other sculptural things from the heritage, Petrova Gora in Croatia, Petrova Gora, this is Kladovo. All collaborations between artists and architects. Very good lesson. Architects do not know how to do art. And artists, as architects, are dull. So when they work together, there is something going on in the chemistry, in terms of planting. Kladovo was also a collaboration between the two very good artists and architects. And inside the everyday life, it's all in disrepair, right? This is the hall for discussions, and you see there is a color, a psychological engineering. Blue is for discussions, concentrate, and then red and yellow is for the bar where you hang out, find your girlfriend or whatever, or something like that. Bogdan Budanović in Mostar, Ken Sotani in Skopje, and also everyday life in my town, one of my towns in Belgrade. This I'm showing, of course, you here went through this period for 10 years before, right? So, I'm not an expert in Kosovo, I'm just saying this in a kind of more global way. Telling it to a far bigger network than what the architects have here, which is NATO, military, and data. And you can see it's also reconnaissance. Same building by Dobrovich, being seen from the plane after the shot. Why is this important? Because NATO bombed its own child. Dobrovich was reading Western philosophy, André Bergson, and you can see the diagrams on the upper right side. Bergson was developing an abstract diagram of dynamics of form, not to be figurative, but to be abstract and dynamic. As you can see down at the bottom drawing, Dobrovich took that and developed this void in the middle of the building for the army. headquarters, claiming that this is what makes the nation divided, not dissolved. This is a video that goes, well, I'm going to speak through. This video was part of the forensic architecture exhibition in Berlin.
Okay, so this is some documents.
So as they go, it is also important to discuss like this conversation, not just what is going to happen, but what should be corrected, but also what has happened.
Capital of Serbia, former capital of Yugoslavia, and focusing largely on the institutional buildings from former Yugoslavia, with or without casualties. Now these two photos are from Armin Linken. They kind of show the situation of the building called Lager headquarters. Also, some other documents from previous research which show the damage of the structure, and also some of the theoretical propositions of the architect. The building was shot twice, on two occasions, and once it was actually caught on camera, which kind of depicts the sort of an evening.
These people who shot that, we got that shot, are the very same people who were in the paramilitary army coming to Kosovo. And why am I saying this? Because sometimes information lies in the enemy. And often we need to cross that line to get the information. So that leads me to the fact of what we call illegal architecture, and I coined the term architecture because of, I'll explain why, which was later used as term urbanism and others. In Serbia, the situation is For 13 years of Milosevic's rule, that it affected everybody. It affected you, it affected me. The entire generation of architects was studying for what, you know? Buildings were being destroyed, and we are learning how to make construction systems. This diagram shows the gradual oppositional the race in the elections, finally until he was toppled. What happened is that at the same time, Milosevic commissioned three projects in 13 years, and one of them, the church in Pristina, unfinished. Second one was the subway station in Belgrade, 1989, first city that doesn't have a subway system, and the monument from 2000 to the Victor survey over the world. So, but at the same time, 1.5 million houses were built and structures along the landscape, quite similar to Kosovo and others. That's 38 per day. This gentleman left is a war criminal. Right? And then he's not with us anymore. The woman right is Turbo Folktiva Zenza. And it's amazing that friends of mine who are gay ask me, tell me which urban this is a man or a woman. Because of so much makeup. And of course that's one of the first Turbo houses from 1989 again by two of them. Other types that were going on because of migration are that this house, the Mushroom House. It explains by the economic diagram on the right. The gray bars are basically the gray economy. The black ones are the registered economy, whatever registered means. But that meant that for the house on the left, family would, you know, escape from Bosnia or Croatia for a small bribe, just settle in a park, open up a little cevapcici joint and serve people. And then overnight, the columns behind a little bit were raised, and then the plate would be made, and the roof would be made, and then the shop is gone. So we have this incredible mushroom element. No matter how it looks like, it's actually an amazing type. We have plenty. Another example, which I was showing a long time ago, is these two buildings, which are done by the same architect and for the same client. Complete schizophrenic situation, because one is a villa on the right, it looks like a villa, and the second one is a TV studio, pink TV studio that produces Turbo Folk, which is music, into different materials. There are other stories that actually involve Orthodox Church, you know, making tin churches, sending them to top hills, top high hills, meaning completely violating the canonic traditional system of building, say, Orthodox churches by brick or by masonry, and so. And also there are some examples where, you know, illegal architecture kind of was built on the wrong side of the tank. This is in Novi Sad on Danube. So what my studio did, we started being very frustrated by this. And I started developing this taxonomy of shapes, because what is not really, we wanted to find something positive about it. And how does the illegality works? If you see
these lines,
that's basically the amount of illegal space allowed. And that's actually straight. Everything else is basically built up on that, and that is illegal. But you can see illegal is shaping, the legal is straight, right? It's like putting a lipstick on a pig. And there are many in different sizes. We find them cute. I found another medium how to express this, because my office at the same time had actual projects, which I read, and all these other ones are kind of there, right? They're untouched. We didn't have power to touch them, we could only be within them. So this is an installation in Stuttgart, in the Academy of Solitude, where I crossed into art, and I had to work with artists. I couldn't do that anymore. Now what's amazing, this is an example of Kosovo between Budanovac and what's amazing is that any process like this, which is self-organized, self-governed, self-regulated, becomes normalized. This is an incredible anonymous motel on that road, which is, has no curbs, has no bellies. It looks like a Mexican burger masterpiece, in fact. In the back you can see still the old kind of turbo. So turbo architecture develops really fast. It doesn't wait, you know, everything is new. It's like television, you know, there's everything is new, the next new thing, the next big thing. Now this image is from Albania, actually. Nobody actually talked about this, you know, every man, every house. This is a father and son. Photo is by Kiln Park. The father on your right, you know, built a house for himself with two stories. The son on the left built it with four stories, you know, anticipating more generations. But they built them in a system which is completely pure, right? And we have to admire that. Why? Because in the history of modern architecture, Le Corbusier did more or less the same, proposing the Le Domino housing, the same principles, right? They just didn't know Le Corbusier, they just knew this is what they need to do in order to secure for new generations. I find it beautiful, in fact, if we talk about beauty. Now there are other examples which are really, now we're going to negation part, right? We went to modernization, we went to purity, now the negation. An example in Bosnia, in a town called Kalesia, which was, you know, the Muslims and the Syrians being fought off. Now it's a Muslim people. They wanted to renovate the city to make it, to beautify it, to talk about beauty. So this kind of color, peach, kind of pink color, is the sign of beauty and healing, and consensus. And but the problem was there was not enough money to do it, you know, from the EU and from the city, so that residents were asked to pitch in, right, to pay half. And then there is one person who refused to do it, right, which you can see in the lineage. Now we can make theories, like why, what happened. If you look at the size of a satellite dish, these terraces, it's much bigger than the other ones, so that's where the money went to. But maybe that's not true. But what's really amazing, is this line, if you see the line, how is the descent is delineated so perfectly. And where you decide where that line really is, right? Where is the property? This is probably the straightest line made in the Balkans. And I congratulate that, you know, it's fascinating. Now, let's go further. I'm going to go very quickly to this project to basically say why globalization is global. People disagree with me, but I think my generation of architects, international architects, are not fully conscious of that. These three gentlemen, Jacques Herzog, Hemingway, and Pierre Dubron, who built the building in the back that you all know, concocted a project to invite 100 semi-young architects to design a villa in the north of China. They sent an email that looked like spam, like this. Dear architect, we want you to do this, do this, do this, do this. And they sent it to 100 architects. 40 did not respond. They just put it in a trash can, right? So, but it was clear this was an art project. It was not simply an architectural project. Wei Wei did a project 10 years ago in the castle, in Documenta, where he invited 1,001 Chinese to travel with him to castle. He designed everything for them, you know, clothing, backpacks, beds, chairs, and they were mainly young Chinese. And they applied by internet and by Twitter. Now this is 100 architects in Ordos in the desert in China, you know, kind of in the same way, where Wei Wei and Herzog and Demeron invited people that are all around the world mostly, but not from China, to actually execute one of the projects. Now this is the location of Ordos. It's basically believed to be the death place of Genghis Khan. It's like Chinese made this myth. to attract people. There's a terrible master plan done by a Singapore company. I'm showing this because when you talk about illegality in formal planning and you compare it to formal planning, you get this. And you get that. Right? And you get these sculptures. The city is still fully empty. It's not moved in. There are also these amazing landscape features. Talk about landscape, the blue palm tree. But why am I saying this? I'm going to make a point very quickly. So these are the architects looking for their site in the desert, right? It's really a desert, it's more like a tundra. Some architects got overdressed, going to the meeting. These are two of my friends, Scott Cohen on top from GSD, Harvard, and David Lewis from Parsons. This was my location with my partner, we found it. And everything was happening in a hotel, and the model. Something that I think would really be useful, say for Krishna, is to have some sort of an interactive model. It's possible. Where everybody was putting their projects, will everybody clapping? I mean, when did you see anybody clapping architecture? So it was a bit of a problem. Some of the projects are this, they're really weird. And they are, you know, they're balconies. François Roche, then there is the ocean liner, and there is the tower by French architects. There's a globe by Singaporeans. This is Sofo Gimato, actually, his garden, Swiss architects concubine, the whole mirrors, Korean architects, and so on, etc., etc. I'll show quickly my project. Basically, I have no clue what to do. And this is what actually we often, if you work in a legal area or in formal space, say, Pristina or Pea or somewhere, it is often you think architectural, like do architecture. You know, we need to lay this, this, do that. And that went on all along until this happened. We were taken to a site visit. You know, all 100 architects, assistants, cameras, and everybody was expecting a site presentation. Like, you know, somebody's going to tell us the numbers, ecology, this, that. Instead, this happened. And of course, I can tell you who the person is, you can guess. The performance was done by Ivory Ray, right? He laid down on the ground, he was covered by sand, and that was it. Now that I told you, now this is the artistic part. Now that I told you, you can say, well, maybe it's not. But you have no means of checking whether it's true or not. So it's a Duchampian way. We immediately took our models, me and my team, and started doing exactly that. We know that Ai Weiwei is a large man, right? So the kind of the mound, sound mound, kind of forensically suggests that this is not a thin guy. It's somebody with a belly and a big chest. So we thought, okay, how can we cover our forums in such a way that we still recognize them, but we don't, and that we control the shape? Same like turbo architecture controls the shape. And how can we make the shape to actually have that control process? So we went through this exercise, very, very artistic, very architectural, but then also went to real technical details where we said, in the desert, that's something that has to be also done in Pristina. What are the conditions? What are the extreme conditions? Conditions in the desert are really extreme. You know, the weather is moss, sand, rain, there's one more thing I forgot, and snow. And they all thought, well, if this is a collection of architecture, let's make it a collection of weather. Let's store it in the facade, and let's play with it, season it. So this is a technical drawing that I can tell my mom, I can actually draw a technical drawing of the facade. And the section, and one of the typical sections that actually show that a triangular grid. I won't get into that. That kind of shows that what happens to the architecture if the higher forces are on it. Structural systems by a British engineer, and then one of the final models which actually show that effect that you saw before. So now imagine this under sand, under snow, under moss, and under rain. Now, all of this what was happening was showing that all our generation is doing, every single young architect is doing, or architect of Generation X, is doing a totally different building. And you could say a completely balkanized building. Why balkanized? I'm going to make this point back. Remember the map of Yugoslavia, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. In the past, Yugoslavia had one capital, right? Belgrade. Now, it has seven capitals. If we are simply economists, we would say this is 700% production of capital cities. Capital city is different from any other city because it needs representation, it needs all the parliaments, it needs new things, and it's not simply. And we do it now seven times. And the second point that each capital city wants to be different from all six others, which actually is happening. So Pristina is different from Belgrade, Zagreb, Ljubljana, Sarajevo, Skopje. Now, in order to do that, so one of the strategies is that what Weber did, not asking anybody that would balkanize, is actually to, he just rebuilt the model that I showed at the beginning, completely in the one same area he put for an art showing in Kassel. And that was fascinating because suddenly I realized that balkanization can be surpassed. It's not negative. It can actually be used. It can be smeared, so to say, or draped in one way or another, realistically. Now, we need, for that, we need to step out of architecture and our urban thinking and, you know, talk to the artists, talk to others. So, you can see the model how balkanized it is. Every single house is completely different. You say it's ugly or beautiful, it doesn't really matter. They're all very good designs. Now, what happened one day is that we were there, I was there in a hotel room. It's like 100 people, so you really have to wait for 3 days, maybe 15 minutes. And the internet was still working, and I ran into this article by Jonathan Steele, The Milosevic Medicine. His point was, this is before Arab Spring, this is before all of what was happening. So he was saying, you know, we are really frustrated with all these dictators around the world, especially Zimbabwe and Mugabe. And he says it literally, you can see it, right? Why don't we make a project that we send him, Mugabe, somewhere to a retreat and, or preferably, to a villa in China. So I was in China designing a villa. And we immediately had this completely unarchitectural thinking, perhaps even a joke, because this is a communist country, there are no clients. So why don't we think of it as a fictional story, while you wait, that we declare this a retreat for all the dictators of the world. Completely fictional and unserious. And then we start making some real research. You know, what do these people in power build? You know, you should do it for your leaders, we do it for ours. This is Mugabe's house, where his wife Lucy, one of the three. And of course you can say this is Kitsch. If you look carefully, there are only two colors involved. So in fact, it's a highly controlled cage. The second point that is actually really struck me, that it was designed by an engineer from another project from Belgrade. And I felt, wow. So what we did, we distributed a list of current dictators then, there were 38 efficient ones, but then they had families, and there are all these others, there are dictators in democracies. And ask everybody, while we're waiting, you know, which house, that, because they're all so distinct, would fit any of them, right? Now that we know that Mugabe likes, what would fit him out of our project? But completely unserious, don't take it seriously. So Mugabe got a building by an amazing Indian architect, Bijoy John. Well, there were others getting their picks. Asimov got the Singaporean globe, because if you analyze his parliament and his chairs, the guy designs everything by himself, and everything is global. Just look at the internet. And there are others and others and others. Logically, we were voted to get Gaddafi because of the sand, because we were preserving the sand, you can imagine. And we don't have that client anymore, because he's not with us. But why I find this kind of, you know, thing interesting and very useful for thinking about problems like in Krishna is that we can step out of this super serious discussions and think of, you know, push the limit and find not just beauty but intelligence in what they are, and some distinct. And that's at the end, you know, of the day, that's how it has been left, you know, what is left, what is behind after this process and after this workshop. So it's not bad to be balkanized. It's quite positive. In fact, there is quality, there's richness in it. It's just the way how it is dealt. And I think it's good to be light, you know, lighter. It's not really a heavy subject. And there it is. So from this model to this smear model, we get a very beautiful landscape by an artist. This person. This is the last sequence. Doing okay? Yeah. 20 minutes. The last sequence of thinking is really about power. You know, I was thinking, since we were talking about power and dictatorships, but really not about dictators themselves, but about architecture that can cross any boundary, anywhere. Meaning that, say, as much as North Korea can receive projects by offices from Canada, because Canada has non-sanctions on North Korea, Krishna can receive projects by Japanese or by others, can actually organize itself to do so. This project was called Romancing Through Power. It was commissioned by the New School in New York. They matched me by a person called Nina Khrushcheva. If it doesn't ring a bell, Khrushcheva is the granddaughter by Nikita Khrushcheva, former Soviet president. She's a professor of political science in New York. And she's obsessed with dictators. We did, this is a very important job. So we got on board to work with her to make an exhibition, kind of a cultural exhibition, which I think can be done here in a very smart way. Thinking, okay, first of all, learning from political science, learning from international affairs, from diplomats. What does it mean to be a dictator? What is the phenomenon? The first thing NAO did was to make this chart. We charted out how many times the dictator was the man of the year out of Times magazine. So these are the faces. And also, when does that phenomenon started? It started with Hitler, who ended up on Times magazine front page. So the West is complicit, of course, and the media is complicit, if you will. So these are all the numbers. These are the numbers of the 20 dictators' families being promoted to be the person of the year. Saddam Hussein wins. He was there 7 times. The current guy, the Donald, is trying to be on it. He actually, I don't know if you read the news, he made fake front pages. He may never end up on it. So we did an exhibition, on which I took quite a lot, and I think this is good, this problematic of legal architecture that deserves exhibition. by doing this timeline on the floor, by actually collecting action memorabilia from each of the families. These are Erdogan's gloves right there. That was the actual gloves by Erdogan that one of the professors of political science collects. Because these people in political science, they're extremely connected. They analyze for CNN, for ABC, but have zero visual and spatial sense. And that's where I come in. That's, you know, that's good to know, I think, in the situation here, where the power is, and what the power does not know about space and about design. And then one can come in. The thing on the up, the frieze, which you see, it's basically constructed frieze of photo dictators holding hands in the air. Basically, we analyzed, this is what information we got from political science people, they never shake. So, democratic leaders shake, dictators declare victory. And they always do it. There was an anecdote recently when Obama went to, before the Donald thing, went to Cuba and, you know, tried to, you know, first hug with Raul Castro, who refused. Then he tried to shake, right? And Raul just took his hand up in the air and Obama kind of enabled. Showing that, you know, the difference between the body language and the sign of the body language. We made these amazing quotes on the wall. Everything was done out of paper. So that alluding that anybody, that is true, anybody can do it in any remote village, adoring their dictator. So putting a piece of paper on the wall is design. That's design. It's not about who is being adored, it's about the design of that. When Milosevic was pre-elected, you know, all the truck drivers, if I remember, had their his face on the front shield. So you would think that he, Milosevic, is driving the car. It was very, very dangerous, in fact, because you limit your sight, but that was that. And one quote which was a very fascinating, which you need to remember in political sense, by Plato, 62 years before Christ, saying that, and I'm going to paraphrase, dictatorship arises naturally out of an extreme liberal democracy. So think of it, what it means today. Extreme liberal democracy, meaning neoliberalism, produces dictatorships, according to Plato. And in respect to the show, the political science people really had fun with this, and they demanded, they wanted to have a polling session, like voting your own dictator. So we had these buckets on the right side, where you could try chips, and we were counting them at the end, and everyone born again. things like that. And then the last thing is that I thought, well, this is, how do we educate this? How do we, you know, this is not, we're not, I was not taught this in school. I was taught this on the street, you know, demonstrating and doing all these things. So I took my students from Colombia to the show. We had classes in, we had books written by authoritarians. And by the way, they're not only in non-democratic systems, they're also in democratic systems. Cheney and Donald. And we had this, you know, really interesting, you know, encounter that we can live with that, you know, by going through it, by design. Architecture can go through any boundary, any political and ideological boundary, because it's technology. This is just a simulation of the making of the show. It was not commissioned by me. People who were there, they just decided they wanted to do this for their own family. And of course it goes to the music of Rimsky-Korsakov, The Flight of the Bees. There were three crews here actually. One crew from NAO, one from the school, and one from the building services. So they have to communicate to each other. Europe is always so complicated. Remember.
times I love you.
Now the last point, the last education. Now, when you think, okay, we have this in the gallery, right? And this is the point. How do we connect things which are institutional and which are not institutional? How do we connect the profession, which is professional, and the unprofessional, which is, say, legal or informal, and self-organized, self-regulated? So now I wanted to do something in the school with these materials and data. This was at Columbia University, here again, Kenneth Frampton, André Jacques, friend of the brilliant with that. And students were kind of given the task to actually make comic books, graphic novels, matching a dictator and their architect, right? A tyrant and an architect, but focusing on the architect, not focusing on the dictator, focusing on what does the architect do in order to get the project, execute the project, and be autonomous. This is a story of Hafez al-Assad, the founder of Bashar al-Assad, current president of Syria, indisputably. And this is Ken Zatani on the left, who really toured the world by doing his brutalist architecture. And but the whole story that I learned, that's why it's good to talk to diplomats, is that Americans advised Bashar to hire not an American, not a Western, not a local, but a Japanese architect as a neutral one. So that's how Kenzo Tani was getting projects according to the American diplomacy. After all, they won the war. And Tani won this. So the students do this, you know, advise them, but this is a very student. They basically now make the story out of facts by making that what would. You know, can we be so kind of crazy thinking what causes a crisis? Now, Tanki builds this palace. It's a very grand, brutalist palace. Maybe without qualities or with qualities. But what happens is that Bashar al-Assad, when he gets elected, he decides to move out of the palace and go to a suburban home. He needs to isolate himself, like one of those homes on the landscape. And we ask the question, you know, is this also the living condition of somebody in power really important? You know, it must be important in order to be transparent, right? And is this what actually causes the hiding of the causes? Speculation. The second one, this one I love, is the Brunei Darussalam, which is a small kingdom in next Malaysia. And with this massive, massive palace, also by Kenzo Tange, I guess, who. And the story is that the Sultan, the supreme leader, built it and had many, many sons who were living opulent lives. And one of them is actually commissioned, and also there is all these issues of harem and inequality and polygamy. So one of them actually commissioned, like in Louvre, like 36 sculptures made of bronze with him and his harem having sex in various positions by an American sculptor. So there are no boundaries, in fact, no matter whether you like it or not. Now the first question was that we were asking, so why is it not in gold? Now, why is it in copper when there are bronze? Was there a cut of budgets? And that's where the investigation starts for an architect. You know, what is this? What is the role of all these parameters that lead to this weird ends? And that's more or less where I would like to end. Where do we find the kind of the essence of the situation, say in Pristina, where we can cut a little slice, right? Then we can really do the research and go deeper. Instead of trying to solve everything at the same time. So thank you. So any questions are welcome. Any jokes are welcome too at this time of the hour.
Okay, give the monitor.
Yes, okay, I'll give you the story. The current, it's unstable, right? So the current administration, meaning Vučić and his crew, they want to take it down, right? They want to destroy it. And they want to sell the land, and they, with military together, they want to build a hotel, okay? The architectural community really got together at this time and managed to protect the building, continuously writing to the president, to the media, that this is a national treasure. You know, it's like a treasure. And there's back and forth, right? So then there was negotiation that the Carter right would come and said, why don't you just take down one side and we keep the other side? And then you don't get the point, you know, this is the fault, which is made by the two sides, right? And that's what Dobrich done. But here's the backstory. Backstory is this, which I was saying, when Dobrich was doing those diagrams, right? His brother was a painter, so he behaved like an artist. And I can guarantee that no general understood what he was doing. You know, they just let him do it. That means that he was an autonomous architect in many, many ways. You know, he kind of went through, right? Now, there were even articles in political paper explaining to the citizen what do this street mean. Why is there no tank on the, you know, why is there no star? There's not even a single star. And even up to today, you know, this is kind of, they talk about children being educated very early on what obstruction is, what this that is that the block in the population's mind is that this is an ugly, right? Because it is not understood as something being experimental, it is not being explained. So what's happening now physically, because of structures, it's not going to be taken down. We have to slice part of the building. There is an agreement that the shell is going to be rebuilt. It is not known what is going to be inside, but who knows how long this is going to take. But I'm actually quite proud of my fellow architects. You know, my group of entities are, your various people like university, but they got together on this issue. And they really confronted the government. So that's what's happening in the process. And they protected it, so it's protected. Well, okay, I'll give you a very quick idea. And that's my PhD thesis. I'm writing my books now. So there are three kinds of organization. The first one was basically geographical, meaning how the Turks defined the Balkans. Balkan means, and literally for Turkish, some mud hill down there. Out there, like non-important, like a set of hills. That's what Balkan means. It's a derogative name. And so, you know, it's the geographical issue of occupation at the beginning of the Ottoman Empire, occupation of this land, and then the way how they did it through land, not through the sea, because Turks went through land. And so that's a geographical understanding. And that's the understanding which actually was coined by a British diplomat in the Atlantic Wars against the Greeks, against the Turks, when the Turks were actually retreating, is that Balkanization was geographical division and fighting between the three pockets of the empire. That meant, and it was very precisely said, it's not the binary opposition. You have to have three people for Balkanization, or three territories, so the triangle, right? So that's number one. Number two is a metaphorical Balkanization, which was theorized and published by Amita Gris. It's a book called Balkan as a Metaphor, where somehow Balkanization got the status you can call anything Balkanization, or anything Balkanized. The international law is Balkanized. The rights are organized. The Iraq will be balkanized. This is about, like, I mapped 178 metaphors of balkanization. Sudan is balkanized. You can find it all the time, even in music. But at the same time, I found out that internet activists who are defending against hegemony of the world are calling balkanization a positive way. Meaning, as long as I surround my code, right, from Google or from all your corporations, it's like a little asterisk on the exchange, you know, that village against the empire is a positive thing. And the third one, which I do argue for, is that it finally comes back to the territory itself, meaning to our territory of former Yugoslavia. So, you know, we had the first one, geographical invasion and evasion, and we had a metaphorical one, which is very arbitrary, and now we can have a real one. That's where I talk about, you know, the quality of distinct capital cities here, you know, the seven capital cities. So that's, if that helps, that's what I explained.
My question was a little bit different. So there is a respectable belief from the Marxist who says that everything below Belgium is wrong.
He's wrong. I mean, that's a metaphorical one. That's what I'm saying, because one can actually spread it. Thank you.